means you're going to hear. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Welcome, everyone. Good evening. We come this night mindful of how much, my brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Tonight, we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of the Lord's Paschal mystery. So that is to say of his passion and resurrection, for it was to accomplish this amazing mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Let us, therefore, with all faith and devotion, commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following as we do this night in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, may we also share also in the resurrection of his life. Let us pray, Almighty and Eternal God, you bless these branches. May we see as we walk and imitate this night Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem, that you and I this night too may enter yet again into Christ's passion and resurrection. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
When Jesus and his disciples drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately on entering it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. If anyone should say to us, 'Why are you doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it, and will send it back here at once.' So they went off, and they found a colt tethered at a gate outside on the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing, untying the colt?' They answered them, 'Just as Jesus had told them,' and he permitted them to do it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches they had cut from the fields. Those preceding him, as well as those following, kept crying out, 'Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace. In the name of Christ, amen. And let us go forth then this night.
Enter into Jerusalem. Let us go to God's house. With the healthy and the sick, with the hungry and the weak, let us go to God's house. Enter into Jerusalem. Let us go to God's house. Come around with the wind and the God who reigns in peace. Let us go to God's house. Celebrate, O Israel. Praise the name of the Lord on high. Praise his name in song. Praise the Lord with a heavenly song. With a heavenly song. With a heavenly song. Praise the Lord. Enter into Jerusalem. Down there, with the young and the old, with the little and the large, make me walk right down there. Enter into Jerusalem, make me walk right down there. Sway to the breeze, with the God who reigns in peace, make me walk right down there. We go celebrate, we go celebrate, we go celebrate, O Israel. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the Lord with a
with your papa and your mama, with your uncle and your aunt. Let us go to God's house. Enter into Jerusalem. Let us go to God's house. Run and catch a breeze with the garden raised with bees. Let us go to God's house. We go celebrate. We go celebrate. We go celebrate. Oh Israel.
Almighty and everlasting God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, cause our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering, so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the wearied. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear. For my part, I made no resistance, neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore at my bed. I did not cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help so that I am untouched by the insults. So too, I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord.
my God, why have you forsaken me?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
All who see me deride me. They curl their lips, they toss their heads. He trusted in the Lord, let him save him. Let him release him if this is his friend.
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Many dogs have surrounded me. A band of the wicked beset me. They tear holes in my hands and my feet. I can count every one of my bones.
My God, why have you forsaken me?
They divide my clothing among them. They cast lots for my robe. Oh Lord, do not leave me alone. My strength, make haste to help me.
My God, why have you forsaken?
I will tell of your name to my brethren and praise you where they are assembled. You who fear the Lord, give him praise. O sons of Jacob, give him glory. Revere him, Israel's sons.
Why have you forsaken me?
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. His state was divine, yet Christ Jesus did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave and became as men are, and being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even to accepting death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend the knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Christ was found a humbler yet, even to accepting death on a cross. But God raised him high.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
It was 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And the chief priests and scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by some trick and have him put to death. For they said,
It must not be during the festivities,
or there will be disturbance among the people.
Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper. He was at dinner when a woman came in with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the ointment on his head. Some who were there said to one another indignantly, "Why this waste of ointment? Ointment like this could have been sold for over 300 denarii, and the money given to the poor." And they were angry with her. But Jesus said,
"Leave her alone. Why are you upsetting her? What she has done for me is one of the good works. You have the poor with you always, and you can be kind to them whenever you wish. But you will not always have me. She has done what was in her power to do. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. I tell you solemnly, wherever throughout all the world good news is proclaimed, what she has done will be told also in remembrance of her."
Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, approached the chief priests with an offer to hand Jesus over to them. They were delighted to hear it and promised to give him money. And he looked for a way of betraying him when the opportunity should occur. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and you will meet a man carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house, which he enters, 'The master says, where is my dining room in which I can eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room furnished with couches, all prepared. Make the preparations for us there."
The disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, he arrived with the 12. And while they were at table eating, Jesus said,
"I will tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me, one of you eating with me."
They were distressed and asked him one after another,
"Not I, surely."
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12. One who is dipping into the same dish with me. Yes, the Son of Man is going to his fate, as the scriptures say he will, but alas for that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born."
And as they were eating, he took some bread. And when he had said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to them, saying,
"Take it. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, and all drank from it, and he said to them,
"This is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many. I tell you solemnly, I shall not drink any more wine until the day I drink the new wine in the kingdom of God."
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all lose faith, for the scripture says, 'I shall strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered.' However, after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said,
"Even if all lose faith, I will not."
And Jesus said to him,
"I tell you solemnly, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times.
But he repeated still more earnestly,
"If I have to die with you, I will never disown you."
And they all said the same. They came to a small estate called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I pray."
Then he took Peter and James and John with him. And a sudden fear came over him and great distress. And he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake."
And going on a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, this hour might pass him. He said,
"Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup away from me. But let it be as you, not I, would have it."
He came back and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Had you not the strength to keep awake 1 hour? You should be awake and praying not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy, and they could find no answer for him. He came back a third time and said to them,
"You can sleep now and take your rest. It is all over. The hour has come. Now the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up and let us go. My betrayer is close at hand already."
Even while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, came up with a number of men armed with swords and clubs, sent by the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the traitor had arranged a signal with them. He had said,
"The one I kiss, he is the man. Take him in charge and see he is well guarded when you lead him away."
So when the traitor came, he went straight up to Jesus and said,
"Rabbi,"
and kissed him. The others seized him and took him in charge. Then one of the bystanders drew his sword and struck out at the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Then Jesus spoke,
"Am I a brigand that you had to set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I was among you teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me. This is to fulfill the scriptures."
And they all deserted him and ran away. A young man who followed him had nothing on but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the cloth in their hands and ran away naked. They led Jesus off to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes assembled there. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the high priest's palace, and was sitting with the attendants, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus on which they might pass the death sentence, but they could not find any. Several, indeed, brought false evidence against him, but their evidence was conflicting. Some stood up and submitted this false evidence against him.
"We heard him say, 'I am going to destroy this temple made by human hands, and in 3 days build another, not made by human hands.'"
But even on this point, the evidence was conflicting. The high priest then stood up before the whole assembly and put this question to Jesus,
"Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence these men are bringing against you?"
But he was silent and made no answer at all. The high priest put a second question to him.
Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am. You will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
The high priest tore his robes and said,
What need of witnesses have we now? You heard the blasphemy. What is your finding?
And they all gave their verdict. He deserved to die. Some of them started spitting at him and blindfolding him, began hitting him with their fists and shouting,
Slay the prophet.
And the attendants rained blows on him. While Peter was down below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's servant girls came up. She saw Peter warming himself there, stared at him, and said,
You too were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth.
But he denied it, saying,
I do not know. I do not understand what you are talking about.
And he went out into the forecourt. The servant girl saw him and again started telling the bystanders,
This fellow is one of them.
But he again denied it. A little later, the bystanders themselves said to Peter,
You are one of them for sure. Why, you are a Galilean.
But he started calling curses on himself and swearing,
I do not know the man you speak of.
At that moment, the cock crew for the second time, and Peter recalled how Jesus had said to him, Before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times. And he burst into tears. First thing in the morning, the chief priest, together with the elders and the scribes, in short, the whole Sanhedrin, had their plan ready. They had Jesus bound and took him away and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him.
Are you the king of the Jews?
He answered.
It is you who say it.
And the chief priests brought many accusations against him. Pilate questioned him again.
Have you no reply at all? See how many accusations they are bringing against you.
But to Pilate's amazement, Jesus made no further reply. At festival time, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone they asked for. Now a man called Barabbas was then in prison with the rioters who had committed murder during the uprising. When the crowd went up and began to ask Pilate the customary favor, Pilate answered them,
Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?
For he realized it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over. The chief priests, however, had incited the crowd to demand that he should release Barabbas for them instead. Then Pilate spoke again.
But in that case, what am I to do with the man you call King of the Jews?
They shouted back.
Crucify him.
Pilate asked them.
Why? What harm has he done?
But they shouted all the louder.
Crucify him.
So Pilate, anxious to placate the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and having ordered Jesus to be scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away to the inner part of the palace, that is, the praetorium, and called the whole cohort together. They dressed him up in purple, twisted some thorns into a crown, and put it on him. And they began saluting him.
Hail, King of the Jews!
They struck his head with a reed and spat on him. And they went down on their knees to do him homage. And when they had finished making fun of him, they took off the purple and dressed him in his own clothes. They led him out to crucify him. They enlisted a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus, who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. They offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he refused it. Then they crucified him and shared out his clothing, casting lots to decide what each should get. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The inscription giving the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And they crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said,
"Aha, so you will destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Then say to yourself, come down from the cross."
The chief priests and the scribes mocked him among themselves in the same way. They said,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now for us to see and believe."
Even those who were crucified with him taunted him. When the sixth hour came, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani."
This means, my God, why have you deserted me?" When some of those who stood by heard this, they said,
"Listen, he's calling on Elijah."
Someone ran and soaked a sponge in vinegar and putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait and see if Elijah will come to take him down."
But Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The centurion who was standing in front of him had seen how he had died, and he said,
"In truth, this man was a son of God."
There were some women watching from a distance. Among them were Mary of Magdala, Mary who was the mother of James the Younger, and Joseph and Salome. These used to follow him and look after him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women there who had come up to Jerusalem with him. It was now evening, and since it was preparation day, that is, the vigil of the Sabbath, there came Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council, who himself lived in the hope of seeing the kingdom of God. And he boldly went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate, astonished that he should have died so soon, summoned the centurion and inquired if he was already dead. Having been assured of this by the centurion, he granted the corpse to Joseph, who brought a shroud, took Jesus down from the cross, wrapped him in the shroud, and laid him in a tomb which had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary of Magdala and Mary, the mother of Joseph, were watching and took note of where he was laid.
Let us be still and breathe in the gravity of what we have just heard. The scripture scholar Mary McGlone, I do believe a distant relative, wrote in America magazine this week, "Liturgy is drama. Holy Week invites us not to watch, but to play our part." In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Three very simple points. Ignatius of Loyola used a very common technique called contemplatio, in which he asks you and I to take a scene from Scripture and imagine us in the scene. So this week, I'd like to invite you to go into the scene of what we've just heard and maybe stay with one person. Maybe if you're feeling as though you have failed the Lord, to stay with Peter and walk with Peter this week. See him as this stubborn man who thought with such bravado and would claim to be the one who would stand with Jesus and ended up betraying him in many ways worse than Judas. You could be like some of the disciples watching from afar and run away because it's too much. Or you could be like the many women of Jerusalem and the many women throughout the centuries who stayed with the Lord, who cared for the Lord, and who never abandoned the Lord. You could be John, the one disciple, the one apostle who stood with Mary and the throng of women, the one known to have placed his head on Jesus's chest. Choose to be in the scene, though, and ask the questions Ignatius would ask you to ponder. Would he see? Would he feel? Would he hear? Would he touch? Second key point. This journeying is a unique type of journeying, is it not? Our way of remembering is very similar to what Jews do this very Passover. It is not a distant way of recalling that Exodus and being freed from slavery. Eucharistic remembering, as we do every time we celebrate Eucharist, is that we place ourselves in the moment because it is happening now. Is that not what we did in our holding the palms and marching as we did in the entrance to Jerusalem and commemorating that indeed Jesus' entrance to Jerusalem, his own passion, his own resurrection, happening every moment of our life. In a sense, we are passing over as he passed over. Eucharistic remembering is not recalling something that has happened in the past. It is that we are in the unique passion of the Lord this week. We celebrate this amazing joy. We celebrate being broken and poured forth with him. We celebrate and agonize on Good Friday. And we walk with him and the women in this incredible Holy Saturday liturgy and Easter Sunday morning. The rhythm of this week is the rhythm of our lives. Is it not that we often experience great joy and then great sadness? Is it not that we are torn in various ways and yet God is with us? Look at the beautiful image of last Sunday and the beautiful image of Jesus in the garden. That he, like us, if we are suffering, cries out to heaven, Lord, take this away from me. Your tears are his tears in this unique way of being people. What is different about this drama, third and final point, is that as the apostles experienced for the first time, Jesus, as a child and prior to this moment in the upper room, used the same prayers of blessing that we use this time and every time prior to the actual Eucharistic prayer. He, like every good Jew, would say, blessed are you, Lord God, for this bread that we are about to eat. Blessed are you, Lord God, for this wine we are about to drink. The difference of this Holy Thursday, the difference in this Mass and every Mass, is that he says to you, take, this is my body. Take, this is my blood. And he invited the apostles, and he invites you and I into becoming the body and blood of Christ. For what? To become broken and poured forth for the many, to reconcile the world in forgiveness. The rhythm of today, the rhythm of our life, is about you and I becoming who we truly are, the body of Christ. I leave you with this poem from a favorite Irish poet. You know I'd have to quote an Irishman. I won't use the accent, though. This is called The Death of the Beloved. Though we need to weep your loss, you dwell in that safe place in our hearts, where no storm or night or pain can reach you. Your love was like the dawn, brightening over our lives, awakening beneath the dark, a further adventure of color. The sound of your voice found for us a new music that brightened everything. Whatever you unfolded in your gaze quickened in the joy of its being. You placed smiles like flowers on the altar of the heart. Your mind always sparkled with wonder at things. Your days here were brief. Your spirit was live, awake, and complete. We looked towards each other, no longer from an old distance of our names, but now you dwell inside the rhythm of breath, as close to us as we are to ourselves. Though we cannot see you with outward eyes, we know our soul's gaze is upon your face, smiling back at us from within everything to which we bring our best refinement. Let us not look for you only in memory, where you would grow lonely without you. You would want us to find you in presence, besides us when beauty brightens, when kindness glows and music echoes eternal tones. When orchids brighten the earth, darkest winter has turned into spring. May this dark grief flower with hope in every heart that loves you. May you continue to inspire us to enter each day with a generous heart, to serve the call of courage and love until we see your beautiful face again in that land where there's no separation, where all tears will be wiped from our mind, and where we will never lose you again. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I believe in one God, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
conceived by the Holy Spirit. Holy Virgin Mary, Son of the Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
ever gracious and loving God, we commemorate your holy entrance into Jerusalem, and we begin this week mindful of how much you walk with us as we pray in your name.
Lord, we pray for Pope Francis and Archbishop Jason, that during this Holy Week, the Lord will make fruitful their efforts to lead the flock in these unsettling days. Give them the wisdom, knowledge, and stout hearts to bring all souls to know Jesus and his unceasing mercy. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
Heavenly Father, on this Palm Sunday, as we remember Jesus' triumphant entrance into Jerusalem, we pray for peace in our hearts, homes, and the world. Lord, strengthen us to advocate for the marginalized and work towards authentic harmony for all your creation. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously
hear us. Merciful God, as we journey through Holy Week, from the joyous procession today to the sorrow of Good Friday and the ultimate triumph of Easter, remind us of the profound love you have for us, a love that endures all trials and triumphs. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
Lord God, we pray for the many who, like Jesus, carry a heavy cross, crosses of homelessness, illness, poverty, and the death of a loved one. We pray also that the Lord will raise up those who, like Simon of Cyrene, will support them on their difficult journey. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
Father, for those of us gathered in this chapel and those who participate via the media, may we keep this holiest of times well and so be drawn more deeply into the saving mystery of Christ's death and resurrection. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
Almighty God, we come before you with many needs and desires, but most of all, we come before you with our need and our desire of you. Be with us and those we prayed for, in Jesus' name.
Song of Virgin and the priest through you.
Of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by the sacrifice made once for all,
may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty God, to give you thanks for our Lord Jesus Christ. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we sing.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna is heel comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is heel comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. Through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and you make them holy. You never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts you have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For in the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving thanks, he said the blessing. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, as we look forward to his second coming,
We offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, may be filled by the Holy Spirit and become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain the inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, and all the blessed apostles and martyrs and saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and the salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with Francis, our Pope, Jason, our bishop, and all the order of bishops, the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously, then, to the prayers of this family we have summoned before you this day. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, for whom you bestow all that is good. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days. By the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, your friends, I leave you peace. My peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Mercy on us.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. How happy are we to be called to the supper of the Lamb.
Jesus. His Father's will, accepting His death, death on a tree. Jesus, the Lord.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your beloved Son you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Thank you, Father, very much for a wonderful celebration. Thank you. Praise God. You gave us something there we won't forget. I think it was something, real food for the journey for this week. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Very beautiful. And of course, ably assisted by our beautiful choir. Beautiful, beautiful choir. Thank you. And thanks to all of you who have come to celebrate on this beautiful day and those who join us through the media. As Father says, we are beginning the most holy and the most blessed and wonderful week that we can all enter into. So of course, here in our center, we have things to help you do that, especially for the Triduum. We will always be here for the Triduum on Thursday evening, our Mass on Holy Thursday, 5:30. So we are accustomed of that time, 5:30 Thursday evening. Good Friday, we have our Good Friday stations. This year, we would not go through town, as town is a little hot these days. So we're going to be going around the savannah, starting at 6 in the morning, okay? 6 o'clock, Good Friday morning, starting from here. We will leave here at 6 to go around the savannah for our Stations of the Cross this year. Praise God. And then after lunch from 1 o'clock, we do the 7 last words of Jesus at 1 o'clock. And at 2:30, we do our Divine Mercy Rosary. And at 3 o'clock, we have Good Friday service. So that is our Good Friday. And Easter Saturday night, that's next week Saturday, not 5:30 because it's not dark enough. 6:30 because we have to light a fire. Right, Father?
Amen.
We have to have that fire.
Amen.
So we have our Mass, Easter Saturday night, beginning 6:30 next week, and on the Day of the Resurrection, Sunday at 8:30 as usual. But we have leaflets at the door. Please take them if you would like to keep remembering the time, and it's also online. So we look forward, sisters and brothers, for all of us joining our hearts and celebrating this beautiful week. And Father has given us a good idea of making a journey. And who are we going to journey with? Let's pick that up and let's make a beautiful journey together. Amen? Amen. Praise God. What a wonderful thing it is to be a Catholic. You know, fine? Let's give the Lord a round of applause for that. Thank you, Lord. Beautiful. God bless. Beautiful. Take your palms and put it up in a holy place. Make a holy spot in your home so that you will remember this beautiful day and this beautiful Lord who has given himself for us. God bless you all, sisters and brothers. Have a wonderful, wonderful weekend and enjoy your dinner. God bless you. Take care.
Let us thank Rhonda for all her service to the Living Water community. Please bow your heads and pray for God's people. Look, we pray, O Lord, on your holy family gathered here and through the media, for whom Jesus Christ, our Lord, did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is ended. Let us go in peace to serve the Lord and one another. Have a wonderful night. Thank you for being here. God bless.
My trophies and